Hey guys, Carter here. This is kind of a different video from what I normally upload, but I'd really like to start getting into tutorials and how-to guides for animation and things like that. So seeing as though you all really liked that one animated water ripple test I posted on Twitter and Tumblr, I thought a tutorial would be a nice treat for you all. If you guys like the format of this video and would like to see more in the future, just let me know in the comments. Alright, enough intro, let's begin! This tutorial relies exclusively on Adobe Animate. Any recent version will be fine, since we'll be dealing with lots of movie clip features here. I'd recommend Flash CS 5.5 or above though, since that's the oldest version compatible with newer Flash documents. You'll also need the free Animate extension Chaos Theory, and I'll link the download page and some installation instructions in the description. Now this technique is pretty complex, and it'll require a lot of symbols, layers, and filters. Therefore, this tutorial will be geared towards those who are familiar with the Animate interface, the tools I just mentioned, and other concepts like basic color theory. Once you have everything ready, continue on to the first section. First things first, open Adobe Animate and create a new document. For this technique, you'll want to consider how you're going to be using it. For example, you might need a larger document size if you'll be using this in a scene where dynamic camera movements are present, and you might need to alter your frame rate depending on the parameters of your specific project. For demonstration, I'm going to be creating a 1080p document at 24 frames per second, but keep in mind such factors when creating yours. The other thing to keep in mind is how long you want your water loop to be. A shorter loop will look less convincing and allow for less movement in the water blobs, and a longer one might cause problems while editing or testing your animation later on. At 24 FPS, I found a duration of 5 seconds, or 120 frames, to be a good balance, but you can use whatever duration you see fit. Now we can get started with developing the ripple effect. We'll create a new symbol by going to Insert, New Symbol. We'll call it Water Driver, since this will be the underlying driver for the filters that'll create the effect. Make sure it's a movie clip so that we can add the filters onto it later. Inside the Water Driver symbol, we'll create a rectangle as a base. Let's rename this blank layer to BG Solid to keep things organized. With the fill color set to white and the stroke empty, we'll draw a rectangle and set its dimensions to about double the size of the stage. Since I'm using a stage size of 1080p, I'll make the dimensions 3840 by 2160. We can also center this rectangle by going to Modify, Align, and then Horizontal Center and Vertical Center. Now that our document is set up, we'll create the random animated gradients needed for the water effect. So when you're ready, continue on to the next section. Now we can lock this layer and create a new one called Radial Gradients. Here, we're going to be animating a gradient fading in and out with a given lifespan, and we'll duplicate this many times and randomly place them across the rectangle. This is what's going to give us the animated blob effect later. This is also what you'll need Chaos Theory for, so make sure you have that prepared now. First, we're going to create another new symbol, and I'm going to call it Water Driver tilde Radial Gradient. This is my special way of indicating that a symbol is a part of another. Also, make sure this is a graphic, since we'll be utilizing the first frame slider that's unique to graphics. Inside this graphic, we'll draw a medium-sized circle with no stroke. The diameter of this circle will influence the size of the blobs, but it will also be proportional to the density of the gradient duplicates, that is, how many instances there are, so keep that in mind as you determine yours. For my purposes, I'm going to use a diameter of 1,600. Make sure to center it as well. Next, we'll give the circle a radial gradient, and you'll need to open the color panel for this. With the circle selected and the fill icon highlighted, open the type dropdown to the right and select Radial Gradient. We'll only need two color stops for this, so the default gradient will work. However, make sure both stops are set to black, and additionally set the alpha of the outer stop to 0%. This will give us a black gradient with full opacity in the center and no opacity along the circle's circumference. Now, we're actually going to animate this gradient fading in and out, with a longer period at the end of the symbol's duration with just a blank keyframe. This will give the gradient a limited lifespan, and in proportion to the density of the gradients in the driver, this can alter the speed of the entire animation. For my animation, I found that a lifespan of 2 seconds provided a good speed in the end. First, extend the duration of the current keyframe to the duration of your animation. In my case, that'll be to frame 120. Then find the frame amount for your lifespan and create a blank keyframe 2 frames ahead. Since the lifespan for my gradient will be 48 keyframes, I'll create one at frame 50. This is because animations in Animate don't start at frame 0. They start at frame 1, and a duration of 48 frames from that point brings us to frame 49. Creating the blank keyframe on the frame after that will allow us to create the shape tweens for the fade more easily and evenly. And speaking of, that's what we'll do now. Next, create a keyframe on the frame in between the start and end of the lifespan. Given what I've said earlier and my total lifespan of 48 frames in mind, I'll go out 24 frames and create the keyframe on frame 25. Then, on the first keyframe, we're going to set the alpha of the other stop to 0% as well, leaving us with a fully transparent circle. We can then duplicate this keyframe by holding the Alt key on the keyboard and dragging it to the end of the lifespan, frame 49 for me. And now we can select the space surrounding the middle keyframe and create the shape tweens. Let's also set the easing of both to ease in out quad. Now we have our finished gradient animation, which we can create duplicates of in the driver. Going back to our driver symbol, we can place the gradient in the center of the symbol, and on the radial gradients layer we made earlier. Let's also make sure to extend the duration of this symbol to that of the full animation. Now, I'm going to duplicate the gradient many times. To give you a good picture, I used 160 instances for my animation, but you can use as many or as little as you want. Just remember that the number of instances determines how dense the effect will be, as well as how easy it will be to edit later. Now we've made it to the chaos theory step. To give you a quick overview of the extension, checking boxes will enable different types of randomness for your symbol instances, and the numerical values will determine the ranges for those types. Here, we'll need randomness for the frame phase and the X and Y positions, and you could also enable the scale for a more interesting effect. For the frame phase, make sure your gradient instances are set to the first frame, and then set the first value to 0 and the second to your animation duration minus 1, which will be 119 for me. For the X and Y values, we'll want the gradients to span at least the visible area of the stage, so we're going to set these values to the width and height of the stage divided by 2 and inverse of each other. Half the dimensions of my stage would be 960 by 540, so for X, I'll enter negative 960 and 960. And for Y, I'll enter negative 540 and 540. Optionally for the scale, I'll just enter a range of 60% to 100%. Now, we're ready to randomly adjust these instances, and this is where the magic happens. I'd recommend going down the list with only one box checked each time, since leaving all of them on at once may cause Animate to stop responding. Even then, this may take a while depending on your specifications, so just be patient. Starting with the frame phase, we'll leave only that checked, and, with the gradient selected, we'll click the big chaos button. Once that's done and you notice a visual difference, we can move on to, optionally, the scale, and then the X and Y positions. If all went smoothly and to your liking, congratulations! You now have your water driver all set up and animated. What's great about this is it looks really satisfying by itself when played back, and since the gradients are looping and share the same duration as the animation in the driver itself, everything flows really nicely. Now you might need to undo certain steps and reshift some things around, like the positions of the gradients, but otherwise, when you're ready, continue on to the next section. Now that we have our water driver done, it's time to start with adding the filters and color effects necessary to make this look, well, like water. First, you'll want to create another new symbol. I'll call this one Water Pattern 1 and set it as a movie clip. The reason for the one is because we'll create a second one later for a nice layered effect. Next, we'll place the water driver inside this new symbol. Now, the trick with this driver is to make a soft, white outline at a certain brightness level, which, given the variation in the driver, will make a convincing water pattern. What I found to work is using the adjust color filter to increase the contrast of the driver, and using two instances stacked on top of each other with offset brightnesses. Too much of a mouthful? Here, let me show you. First, we'll add the adjust color filter itself. We'll set the contrast to the maximum of 100 and alter the brightness some, which will prioritize a different brightness level depending on its setting. For the first pattern, I set this bottom instance to a brightness of 30. Then, duplicate this symbol by copying it and pasting it in place with Ctrl-Shift-V. We'll want to invert the colors of this one, so set its color effect to advanced, turn the RGB multipliers down to -100% each, and turn the add-ins up to 255. Finally, in the adjust color filter, set the brightness of this top instance to something lower, which will give us the outline we need. I set mine to something 20 units lower, so given 30, I set the other to 10. And look at that! There's the outline we need. You can play around with the brightness values if you'd like, which can alter the placement and thickness of the outline, and you could also experiment with more or less contrast depending on your style preference. For example, if you wanted to add more and give it a more cel-shaded feel, just add another adjust color filter to both and turn it up from there. Once you're happy with the look of this first water pattern, we can now duplicate the symbol from within the library and call the new one Water Pattern 2. Here, you'll want to adjust the brightness level so that, when the two patterns are stacked, you have another outline around the first. In this case, I set the bottom instance to -70, and the top one to -100. We'll be adding transparency to the second pattern in the main timeline, so for added contrast, you might want to increase the range between the two a bit. Finally, the hard part is over. We can start assembling everything in the main timeline. Depending on what you choose to add, you'll need a lot of layers for this. Even for the basic effect, you'll need at least 8 or 9, and that increases once you add a character or other special effects. You can choose to set yours up however you like, but I'll show you what I did for my water effect to give you some ideas. For the first layer at the bottom, I'll place the first water pattern at the center of the stage. I'll also give it a brightness of -20% using the color effects, and a high quality blur of 16 on both axes. On a second layer above, I'll actually make a full-sized rectangle with a dark gray color, hex color 222222, and convert it to a movie clip called Water Brightness. Then, I'll just set it to the screen blend mode. This will give us a slightly lighter color for the water, and a base to add some faint pattern-based shadows in a bit. On a third layer, I'll now place the second water pattern. I'll give this a blur of 16 as well. And I'll also set the alpha to 15%, and the blend mode to add. On the fourth and fifth layers, I'll create those faint shadows I mentioned, which will help give the final effect more contrast and depth. First, I'll copy the water pattern 1 symbol from the first layer and paste it in place on the fourth layer. I'll then set its color effect to advanced, with the RGB multiplier set to -60% and the add-in set to 153. This inverts the colors just slightly. Then, I'll set the blend mode to overlay, and the blur to 128 on both axes. Finally, I'll duplicate this on a fifth layer, and only modify the blur, this time to 255. On a sixth layer, I'll create a full-sized rectangle, and set the color to a nice seafoam green one. This will be used as the underlying color for the water, and you can set this to something more blue if you want. I'll convert this to a movie clip called Watercolor, and I'll set its alpha to 50%, and the blend mode to overlay. On a seventh layer, I'll create another full-sized rectangle, and give it a linear gradient with two stops. We'll want to base the colors of these stops off of the watercolor you made earlier. So just copy the color from within the watercolor symbol, paste the color into the stops, and set the left stop to something darker, and the right one to something lighter. Then I'll use the gradient transform tool to span the gradient across the shape of the rectangle, and optionally offset its angle clockwise a little. Then I'll convert this to a movie clip called Water Gradient, and set its blend mode to hard light, which maps the colors below it to the gradient quite nicely. I'll also duplicate this gradient on an eighth layer, and set its blend mode back to normal, and its alpha to 30%. Optionally, on a ninth layer, we can give the water some extra brightness adjustments from top to bottom using the water driver symbol itself. First, I'll place it in the center, and copy it to the clipboard. And then I'll offset it upwards to something like 180. Then I'll paste it in place, at its original position, and offset it down the same amount, this time to something like 900. For the top instance, I'll use the advanced color effect again, and I'll set the RGB multipliers to negative 50%, the add-ins to 255, and the alpha multiplier to 15%. This inverts the colors and brings the black level up to gray, the neutral color for the overlay blend mode, while giving it less strength as well. I'll then give it the overlay blend mode, and give it the adjust color filter with no adjustments. Why? Well, when we stack all of the gradients together in this step without something to flatten the colors and transparency, this creates some weird visual artifacts that we obviously don't want. Using this filter without adjusting anything keeps everything, for the most part, intact while preventing those artifacts. Then, for the bottom instance, we'll do almost the same thing as the top one. Give it the overlay blend mode, the adjust color filter with no adjustments, and an alpha of 15% with the advanced color effect. Then, this time, we'll just set the RGB multipliers to 50% each. This brings the white level down to gray instead. And that's it for the effect. If you've been following thus far and have all of your timing set right, you should be able to export the animation and watch the water do its thing. If it doesn't work, you may be able to re-watch certain steps in the video and narrow down any errors you come across. Otherwise, you might have to ask a friend to export it for you, or redo certain parts of the effect to optimize it a little. Now that we've successfully completed the effect, I'm going to share some final touches I added and some ideas of how you can customize it. When you're ready, continue on to the next section. Now, this section will be a little shorter given that I've demonstrated everything necessary in detail already, but I'd like to take this moment to share some extra things you can do to finalize this for a full, standalone scene, like the finished version I posted on my socials. Also, if there's enough interest, I may share the final file setup so you can see how I made everything work behind the scenes. First, I'll show you how you can add a character floating on top of the water. I started by drawing the still of Warren in a symbol called Warren tilde still. Then, I placed this inside another symbol called just Warren, and I also duplicated it and gave it an inner drop shadow with a light green color, an angle of 80 degrees, no blur, and the screen blend mode. Unfortunately, this causes some weird issues with Warren's jug, which is translucent, so I just swapped the symbol with a duplicate with the translucent areas filled in. I then created a Warren T1 graphic for his rotation, and a Warren T2 movie clip with the T1 graphic inside of it for the random movement. I had used the Shaker 2 command to give it different states of random positions, and then I duplicated those keyframes two times in succession so the easing issues with the spline tween command could be negated. I then spaced out the keyframes so that it was three times the length of the animation, making sure to re-enter the frame numbers for consistency, and used the spline tween command on all of them. Finally, I isolated the second group of keyframes so that the duration was back to normal. Then I just placed him on the stage above the other layers and scaled and rotated him to fit within the composition. As for its shadow, I used a technique inspired by the Photoshop extension Shadowify, which utilizes many drop shadows layered on top of each other to create the effect of a long shadow. I had this effect ready in a separate file, so I brought it in, set the angles correctly, and swapped the symbols to the Warren T2 one. These layers were inside a symbol called Warren Shadow tilde raw, and I used this inside another symbol called Warren Shadow to get the transparency I needed, which only needed to be 20%. Then, I duplicated Warren's instance on the main timeline and swapped it with the shadow. I sent this instance to the back and gave it an alpha of 60%, the overlay blend mode, and the adjust color filter with no adjustments. Now this gave a nice effect, but there was still some highlights from the water pattern peeking through, so I duplicated the shadow again and placed it on a new layer below the watercolor. I reset the color effects, blend mode, and filters of this instance, since the layers above it would already blend it in, and I only gave it a blur of 16 afterward. Now the last things I added were some color adjustments. First, I created a large circle above the stage and gave it a radial gradient with black on the outside and a brown color on the inside. I converted this to a symbol called Light Rays Gradient, set its color effect to advanced with 50% plus 128 for the RGB channels, and set its blend mode to overlay. I also duplicated this instance and made a duplicate of the symbol in the library called Light Rays. Inside, I drew some random lines converging to the center and deleted portions of the circle in between and around the pairs of lines.
Oh look, it's a bursty.
Then on the stage, I just gave it a blur of 64 to soften it. Finally, on a layer above everything else, I just inserted the watercolor symbol again and set its alpha to 10% and its blend mode to hard light. This just allowed the entire piece, as well as Warren, to blend together quite nicely. Then I just added my watermark and bam! The final animation was done, and this is the version I settled on for my socials. Don't you just want to stare at this playing for hours? Just me? Okay, anyway. This video has gone on for long enough, and I think it's time to wrap it up. I encourage you all to try this out if you can, and experiment with incorporating your own style into it. There's honestly so many ways you can customize it to your liking. Just look at all those symbols and colors and effects just dying to be tinkered with! Plus, you don't necessarily have to use this for water. For example, if you increase the lifespan of the driver gradients to slow everything down and modify the colors and effects a little, you can transform the refreshing water into molten lava before your own eyes. You can also make other modifications to create a pool of acid or even a sea of... however you classify that. Just don't be afraid to deviate from the steps I've described and make this effect your own. Creativity is king, so don't shy away from it. Regardless though, I hope you enjoyed sitting through this entire tutorial. Again, this is my first time doing something like this, so let me know what you think in the comments. Otherwise, I'll see you next time. And remember everyone, to think bright.
Holy shit!